has been stained and from blood.
Okay, only verse 18. James is talking this because he is telling that the Gentiles are free from the law. And he says, known unto God are all his works. From when? From the beginning of the world. Known unto God are all his works. In other words, God knows what are his works. God knows what each one is going to do. God knows when the sparrow is going to fall. God knows when, how many of my hair is going to fall. When? He knows it right at the beginning, before the foundation of the world. Or when the beginning had the beginning. He knew it all. 1 Samuel 23. If you can please take and keep it so it will save us time.
23 chapter,
chapter 23, verse 11 and 12.
11 and 12. Will the men of Gilead surrender me into his hand? Will you come down as your servant who has heard? O Lord, the God of Israel, please tell your servant. And the Lord said, he will come down. Then David said, will the men of Gilead surrender me and my men into the hand of Saul? And the Lord said, they will surrender you.
Now, David goes to fight the Philistines. And then David, he says, will the men of Keilah deliver me up into their hands? Will Saul come down as thy servant has heard? And then the Lord said, he will come down. And David said, will the men of Keilah deliver me and my men into the hand of Saul? And the Lord said, they will deliver thee up. Now, it looks as though all this is going to happen. But who is the one who is causing it? It is the Lord God who is causing it. He is the one who's causing that David should be handed over to Saul, that Saul will come down. You can read Matthew chapter 11, verse 21 and 23. Woe unto thee, Chorazin, woe unto thee, Bethsaida. For if the mighty works which were done in you had been done in Tyre and Sidon, they would have repented long ago in sackcloth. Verse 23. But you, Capernaum, which are exalted unto heaven, shall be brought down to hell. For if the mighty works which have been done in thee have been done in Sodom, it would have remained until this day. But I say unto you that it shall be more tolerable for the land of Sodom in the day of judgment than for thee. And you must forgive me. I think, though this is talking of God knowing fully well that Sodom and Gomorrah and about Chorazin and the sin that has been committed there. There are some verses which are not actually relevant there. And I think we need to cut that out. But in this case, all that Matthew is writing is saying that God knew well in advance which city is going to be horrible. To which city is God going to be merciful? God has decreed it, God has ordained it, and those things will come to pass. Let's look at the second half of it. But he did not order that something should happen because he knew what was going to happen in the future, or because he knew that in a certain situation, certain things will happen. In other words, God did not predetermine based on foreknowledge or prior knowledge. I'm sorry, it's prior knowledge. God did not predetermine things based on prior knowledge. Rather, he determined things so things happen. And that's what he's saying. He did not order that something should happen because he knew that was going to happen in the future. So so it basically looks like because something based on his prior knowledge is going to happen, God says, okay, let me determine that it should happen. It's like putting the cart before the horse, whereas God has determined it so that those that which he has determined will follow him. Peter and Romans 9.
Romans 9.
Verse 11, 13, 16 and 18.
Though they were not yet born and had done nothing either good or bad, in order that God's purpose of election might continue, not because of the work, but because of him who calls.
Verse 13.
As it is written, Jacob I loved, but Esau I hated.
16.
So then it depends not on human will or exception, but on God who has mercy.
Verse 18.
So then he has mercy on whomever he wills, and he harden whomever he wills.
This is if you look at verse 11, God chose, he says, Jacob have I loved and Esau have I hated. When did he do that? Before the children were born. Before they could have done good or evil, so that election might stand, not of works. We need to underline that, not based on works, but of him who called it, because God called it so that God has ordained it, and God has set his love on Jacob. And he hated Esau. What did they do? What did Jacob do to make God to love him? What did Jacob do so that he could turn God's heart towards him? Nothing. Because it's very clearly says, Paul says, before they were born, before they did good or evil, he has ordained it. So, and then he said, I have set my love on him. Irrespective of who he is, to what extent he is a sinner. If God has set his love on him, he has set his love on him. The gift and the calling of God is irrevocable. God is immutable. God does not change. Verse 14, what shall we say then? Is there unrighteousness with God? Absolutely no. We cannot treat God on the same level as we as humans think. God is a spirit, and his world itself is totally different. Whatever he does is absolutely right. We cannot judge God with our human senses, but we learn about him through the scriptures alone. Verse 16. So it is not of him that will it, nor of him that run it, but of God who showed mercy. I can pray 48 hours and 24 hours a day and think that God is so pleased with me. It's not of him who will it or run it. I can will to do so many things. Like, how many, even I have done this. Lord, if you pass me in the exam, I will pray so many hours. We have a barter with God. or we say we will do so much of work for you. But it is God who shows mercy. All that we do cannot influence God, because God has already ordained it before the foundation of the world. Because he has written the name of his elect in the Lamb's Book of Life. And nothing can thwart what he has ordained. Verse 18, therefore has he mercy on whom he will have mercy. He will show mercy to whom he will it. And whom he will, he hardeneth the hearts. If God has hardened a person's heart, who can open it? None. If God has willed a person to come, and if he is in the greatest depths, even in the depth of hell, who can stop him from being delivered and saved? God is sovereign. He is greater than all. He is the one who has ordained everyone's, every individual's life. Again, let me go back to Isaiah 46. And I love that verse in Isaiah 46 so much. He says, verse 3, hearken unto me, O house of Jacob, and all the remnant of the house of Israel, who are born by me, who are carried by me from the belly, and who are carried from the womb. He says in verse 5, to whom will you liken me? Who is my equal? Who will you compare me with? There is none. Remember, man is a creature. We just cannot question God. We are a clay in the potter's hand. Verse 9, remember the former things of old, for I am God and there is none else. I am God and there is none like me. Why? Verse 10, why is he so unique from anyone else? He declares the end from the beginning. None of us can do that. And from ancient times he has the things that are not yet done, saying, my counsel shall stand and I will do all my pleasure. My counsel shall stand and I will do all my pleasure. Isaiah chapter 48 verse 3, I have declared the former things from beginning, and they went forth out of my mouth, and I showed them, I did them suddenly, and they came to pass. Because God has ordained it, God has said it. Psalm 33. Verse 9, verse 8, let all the earth fear the Lord. Let all the inhabitants of the world stand in awe of him. He says, let the earth fear the Lord, because God can, what God has decreed, none of us know. Let us fear the Lord, because God is omnipotent. He is all powerful. Whatever he says will come to pass. And also he says, that the psalmist says, let all the inhabitants of the world stand in awe of him. For to whom will you liken him to? To whom can you compare the true and the living God to? Because he is at work constantly, and what he has declared and what he has said is decreed and will happen. Verse 9, for he spake and it was done. When he spake in time past, in eternity, and it's as good as he has done it. Though it might take place years later, Christ was slain before the foundation of the world. But he came back. He came into the world 2,000 years ago. 4,000 years after the world was created. What he spake before the foundation of the world, it was done. He spake before the foundation of the world. Gilbert, you are my child. And it's happened after 6,000 years. At his appointed time. Because what God speaks will come to pass. And then it says, it was done. He commanded it. And what happened? It stood fast. In other words, it was so firmly fixed, no one can change it. Verse 10, the Lord bringeth the counsel of the heathen to naught. Men can plan. He can destroy the plans. He maketh devices of the people of no effect. Verse 11, the counsel of the Lord standeth forever. The counsel of the Lord standeth forever. The thoughts of his heart to all generation. We worship the true and the living God. God is alive. God hears, God speaks, and he does. This leads us to another question. Predestination to eternal life and death. That's our third point. Predestination to eternal life and death. By the decree of God, for the manifestation of his glory, some men and angels were predestined unto everlasting life, and others foreordained to everlasting death. By the decree of God, let me repeat it. By the decree of God, God's decree is for one purpose, for his own glory. For the manifestation of his glory, some men and some angels were predestined unto everlasting life. We may think if God saves the whole world, that is for his glory. No. Everything he does is for his glory alone. And others foreordained to everlasting death. He sends a man to hell, that is for his glory. He saves a man, that's for his glory. All that God does is only for his glory. We cannot say only if men are saved, then he is glorified. Some human beings and some angels, or that is both men and women, are predestined to eternal life. 1 Timothy 5:21.
I charge you before God and the Lord Jesus Christ and the elect angels that you observe these things without prejudice, doing nothing with partiality.
You see, this is the only verse in the whole of the whole Bible where we can think of angels being elect. But we read other passages of scriptures where it talks of the fallen angels. So it clearly proves the fallen angels were made, created in such a way that God made them reprobates, reprobate angels. The elect angels are impeccable. They cannot fall. So Paul is writing, I charge thee before God. This is being inspired by the Holy Spirit that Paul writes this. He says, I charge you before God and the Lord Jesus Christ and the elect angels. The one-third angels who fell are reprobates. They are created in such a manner that they will fall. How did Lucifer sin? Who caused Lucifer to sin? Today, people say, oh, the devil is doing all this. But who caused Lucifer to sin? Turn with me to Isaiah 14. Isaiah 14. Verse 12. How art thou fallen from heaven, O Lucifer, son of the morning star? How art thou cut down to the ground, which didst weaken the nation? For you have said in your heart, I will ascend into heaven. Who caused Lucifer to say in his heart? Who inspired or who made Lucifer to think that he will ascend unto heaven? Who made Lucifer to say, I will exalt my throne above the stars of God? Who tempted Lucifer to seek for that position where he said, I will sit also among the mount of the congregation in the north sides of the, in the sides of the north? Who gave him that ambition? I will ascend above the heights of the cloud. And who made him greedy for that position? I will be like the Most High. Isn't it coming from within Lucifer himself? Ezekiel 28. It says, verse 15, thou wast perfect in your ways from the day you were created till iniquity was found in you. Till iniquity or till sin was found in you. And we saw what that sin was. God's perfect will is accomplished by the secondary sources, by the secondary agent. Here we see Lucifer himself. God has ordained Lucifer to fall, and Lucifer himself fell because what came out from his own heart. Some angels and some men and women are predestined to everlasting life. For God so loved the world. Here I will read John 3:16 for you. For God so loved the world. Let me read from verse 14. And as Moses lifted up the serpent in the wilderness, even so must the Son of Man be lifted up. And then verse 15, that whosoever believeth in him should not perish, but have eternal life. Look at verse 15 carefully. That whosoever believeth in him, mark those words, whosoever. The whosoever are the ones whom God has ordained, that whose names are written in the book of life. They will believe in him, that they should not perish, but have eternal life. Now, verse 16, continuation of verse 15, for God so loved the world. Which world is it? That he gave his only begotten son. Isn't it for the whosoever who will believe on him? If I can simplify it, isn't it for the world of the elect? That whosoever will believe on him, that God gave his son for them. Again, it's written that whosoever believeth in him should not perish, but have everlasting life. Matthew 25 verse 41.
Then he will also say to those on the left hand, depart from me, you cursed, into the everlasting fire prepared for the devil and his angels.
Let me go a little further to verse 32. Verse 31. When the Son of Man shall come in his glory and all the holy angels with him, then shall he sit in the throne of his glory. And before him shall be gathered all nations, and he will separate one from another as a shepherd divided his sheep from the goats. Remember, a sheep cannot become a goat and a goat cannot become a sheep. The Lord is my shepherd, I shall not want. Isaiah 53 says, we like sheep have gone astray. Does not say we were like goats and gone astray. We all like sheep have gone astray. The shepherd lays down his life for the sheep, John 15. The sheep are never the goats. The goats are never the sheep. But to the goats, he has foreordained them unto eternal life, eternal damnation. He says, depart from me, you cursed, into everlasting fire, prepared for the devil and his angels. Even this is for the glory of God. Romans 9.
Verses 22 and 23.
Yes,
Auntie. What if God, although willing to demonstrate his wrath and to make his power known, endured with much patience vessels of wrath prepared for destruction? And he did so in order that he might make known the riches of his glory upon vessels of mercy, which he prepared beforehand for glory.
Let's look at verse 18. We saw verse 18. Therefore, he has mercy on whom he will have mercy, and on whom he will he harden it. So immediately the human question comes is, why do you find fault with me? For who has resisted your will? And what is Paul's answer? But, O man, who are you to reply against God? And he gives two illustrations. The first illustration he makes of a vessel, of a potter and a clay. And I would say the second is between a creator and a creature. The first, when he says, as a potter and a clay, he says, has not the potter power over the clay? Will the clay say, why have you made me thus? He can make a beautiful vase. He can make a vase for drinking, a pot for drinking water, or he can make for something of this of use for dishonor. A clay has no power over what the potter does with him. And he says, to make one vessel unto honor and another vessel unto dishonor. Verse 22. Now you are talking of a creator and a creature. The first one was a potter and a clay, and the Spirit of God is making Paul write this. What if God, willing to show his wrath, to make his power known, endured with long suffering the vessels of wrath fitted for destruction? Keep a finger there and turn with me to Genesis. Genesis 15. God is telling Abraham, saying that his generation will be in bondage in Egypt. And he's giving them a time. He says, verse 15, Genesis, and you shall go to your father in peace, and you shall be buried in a good old age. And then in verse 16, he says, but in the fourth generation, they shall come thither again, for the iniquity of the Amorites is not yet full. And when it becomes full, he says, I'll bring judgment. So it will take four generations for them, for the iniquities or for the sins to add up sin to sin, so that he can bring judgment. So when you're talking of long suffering, in this case, God is just patient for the cup to fill up. His long suffering is not for them to repentance, but a long suffering unto filling up the iniquities. I will come to 2 Peter, where it says God is long suffering, because everyone will jump to that. We will deal with that verse later. Verse 23, and that he might make known the riches of his glory on the vessels of mercy, which he had before prepared unto glory. If you are saved, why are you saved? Are you not taken from the same lump of clay as a vessel of honor? Are you not the one who have been damned along everyone else on the way to hell? But he says, Gilbert, I have chosen you. You are my sheep. And all the elect, he says, you are my sheep. And how does and God sees to it that the gospel will come to you, the truth will come to you, and the truth will set you free. For the gospel is about his son, and the gospel is the power of God unto salvation. It is by no other means. This happened because of God's order, which is for making his glory known. Yes, we might feel sad if someone is going to hell. But we can't help it, because God has ordained it. We pray that Lord have mercy and save them. But they will reject the gospel. Come to John chapter 3. And I will close with this. John chapter 3, verse 18. It says, he that believeth on him is not condemned. Because we read of the whosoever, they were the ones who were ordained of God. He that believeth on him is not condemned. But he that believeth not is condemned when? Already? That condemnation has already taken place before the foundation of the world. Because he had not believed the name of his only begotten son. John chapter 6. Verse 37. All that the Father giveth me shall come to me. All that the Father has ordained unto salvation before the foundation of the world will come to our Lord Jesus Christ. They will come to him. And those who come to him, Jesus says, I will in no wise cast him out. Verse 39. And this is the Father's will, that whom he has given me, or whom he has sent me, that all of which he has given me, I should lose nothing. I should lose nothing, but will raise them up again at the last day. Verse 44 is a stamp. No man can come to me except the Father who has sent me draw him. That is why we need to be preachers of the gospel with all all boldness. There are many who reject the gospel. Yes, we do not know who the elect are, who will come to the Lord, so we keep giving them the gospel again and again. We pray for them that if they are a sheep belonging to God, that He will cause them to turn to Him. But they cannot come to God on their own. And then again Jesus says, I will raise them up at the last day. Verse 65. And He said, therefore said I unto you, no man can come unto me. No man can come unto me except it were given unto him of the Father. Except it were given unto him of the Father. I will stop here with this last verse, Philippians. Chapter 1. Verse 27. Only let your conversation be as it becometh the gospel of Christ, that whether I come and see you or else be absent, I may hear of your affairs, that you may stand fast in one spirit, with one mind, striving together for the faith of the gospel. And verse 28, in nothing terrified by your adversaries, which is to them an evident token of perdition, which is a proof of their destruction, because they are your adversaries. If they reject the gospel that you preach and you give them, you know they are your adversaries. It's a clear sign of them being children of perdition, or an evident token of perdition. That's a sign. The rejection of the gospel is absolutely the sign that they have been, they are vessels of God's wrath. They have been prepared for destruction. That is what is to them. But to you, of salvation, and that is of God. But to you, he's very specific. To you, the saints at Philippi, or the saints at Hyderabad, to you, it is given to you for salvation, and that is of God. Verse 29, for unto you it is given in behalf of Christ. It is not earned by you, but it is given to you, not only to believe on him, but also to suffer for his sake. And here is classic example where you can put a test. Those who do not want to suffer for him have actually not believed him, because it was not given to them to believe on Christ. But those to whom it is given, they believe on Christ because of who God is. And Jesus says, no man is greater than his master. They have persecuted me, they will persecute you. And these people to whom it has been given, they'll happily take any kind of persecution, no matter what it is. They will not run hither and thither, because they have been so rooted and firmly grounded. No man can pluck you out of my hand or out of my Father's hand, for all of them have been sealed by the Holy Spirit. It's a three-lever, holy, divine, omnipotent lock that no one can snatch you from a triune God's hand. Because God has decreed it. God has decreed who should have eternal life and those who are unto eternal damnation.